Yeah, if you
want. Actually, it's fine. I'll stay here. Hey, guys. Good to be back. It's been, I think, 4 years since last time I was here. And it's been a long, long time since I used to kind of live here, temporary. So, yeah, it's been quite a journey for me as well. So I left here in 2011. Like, from here, I directly went to Romania to get married, to come back, to start my school, which never really happened. I got married. Actually, you can go on with my PowerPoint if it's possible. Most of you guys don't know me. I know some of you guys. So I just kind of want to say a couple words about who I am and what I do. And then we can go on to read the word and hopefully we can leave tonight with a better understanding of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. I'm a hardcore fan of discipleship. Our church is, we have over 15 small groups, 22 leaders, so we're definitely on the discipleship game as well. And tonight I want to talk about, you know, fan or followers. So that's the message. But before that, let me just introduce myself a little bit. Most of you don't know me, so I think that's a good way to start. Thank you so much. Appreciate for the fact that you guys were kind enough for me to speak. Now listen, if my English gets pretty bad, listen, man, I have been in Romania for the last 9 years, so, you know, they say I have an accent, you guys say I have an accent, so it's like, I don't get, you know, both worlds at the same time. Does the PowerPoint work? Okay, so, what am I doing? Recently, I just finished, hopefully with God's help, I'm going to finish chapter 3 of my doctorate. I'm doing preaching and leadership at Asbury Theological Seminary, which is in Kentucky. A very good school, by the way, for any of you who want to go to towards like leadership and stuff. They're really good on that. So I'm my fourth year right now. That's what I'm doing in terms of my educational field. I'm also the pastor of a Romanian church. I've been doing this for the last 9 years. God called me to, not really called me, I got stuck in Romania. I don't know. It's that's kind of calling. I don't know. You can go on to the next slide. That wasn't exactly part of the plan. In 2011, I went back to Romania to get married, and the plan was to come back and, as I said, go back to school to get my PhD at Princeton. And so what happened was my paperwork were not coming in. It's like I got married on May 21st. By the way, that was the year that some dude from Florida said Jesus was coming on May 21st. And I was like, come on, dude, for my wedding? Are you kidding me? I waited for like 25 years for this. You know? Anyways, yeah, so I was praying, God, please just delay one more day. You know, somebody needs to get saved on the 21st. Yeah, so anyways, I got married. Things were going well. I was living with my in-laws. That's amazing when you live with your in-laws. You know, it's always the other opposite way. That's not really amazing when she lives with your mom. And so the paperwork was not coming. The immigration, they were not saying anything. So I got stuck. It's like September. I was supposed to get back already. I was depressed because I started paying my student loans. That's always depressing, right? It was like $220 every month. I was not working. I had like 7 years of theology in my head. And that's about it. No money in my account. Yeah. And, you know, I just like, Lord, this is so depressing. And it's like, here am I living in my in-law's house. My wife was, she's a chiropractor, and she's like working for like $250 pretty much. We had to pay everything for my student loan. I was like, you got to do something. I mean, this is just not right. Something's going wrong with this whole plan. And so as I was praying, I felt, I went to visit my mom. My parents are divorced. So most of my family lives in Michigan, but my mom, she's in Romania. So I was like, I told my wife, hey, I want to go and see my mom. So let's go. And as I was there in Târgoviște, where I passed the church, one of the leaders, one of the elders said, hey, you know, what are you doing? He was like, do you really want to know? You know, most people say, ce faci? It's like, you know, a nice convenient way of saying, you know, I got like 2 minutes. Can you say fast? So I was like, do you really want to know what I'm doing? And so I kind of pour out my heart and say, man, I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing, really. So he said, hey, by the way, we have like an open spot if you want to come here. And I was like, yeah, of course, I'll take anything. So initially I said I was going to stay for 6 months. It's been 9 years now. So I used to be, you know, just a deacon for a long time, and with God's help, for the last 3.5 years, I'm the senior pastor of a thriving church. It's growing. We tripled in the last 7 years. We started with 100 and some people. Now we're over 300. With the kids, maybe like 380. So God is doing some amazing stuff. Right before I came, 3 people gave their life to Jesus. And I really believe that this COVID thing is for the church to wake up and to really do what's supposed to be doing, preaching the gospel and discipling people for the gospel and for the life of the kingdom. Amen. All right, what else about me? I also lead, I'm an assistant coordinator of leadership. So if you guys are ever interested in leadership stuff, I have a lot of information on that. I'm right now, that's what I'm doing right now in Romania. That's kind of part-time. And also, my family. I got 3 kids. I don't look like I have 3 kids, right? this is my crazy family. That's Rebecca Joy. Maybe I should start with my wife. Yeah. My wife is Ronella. She's with the glasses there. My oldest is Rebecca Joy. She's 6.5. My middle child is Danny. He cries more than the girls do, so I'm not sure what happened there. And Anna Grace, she's the youngest. She's the leader of the family. She's the leader. The youngest are always like, you know, more obnoxious, and they're like, you know, they want their ways, and they usually get it. So, but I'll take care of that. She's 2.5, so we're working with that. Yeah, that's about my family. This is who I am, and as I said, I'm here for just a couple more weeks, and I'm going back to Romania, so pray for me and for the family and what's going on there. Okay, so I want to get into this message tonight. If you guys have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to Luke chapter 14. I want to read a passage that talks about the cost of being a disciple. Luke chapter 14, starting with verse 25. I'm going to read from the NIV. You guys could just follow on your version as well. Amen. That's right. He's, praise God. Michael, you got 2 kids?
Third on the way.
Wow. Mulțumesc. I'm just kidding. That's a Romanian way of saying, keep on going, brother. Anyways. So the Bible says this. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus. Now, this is important, okay? So he's not just a loner, you know, like 2-3 people are showing up. He's got thousands of people flocking to Jesus because of the miracles, because of the food, because of everything that's going on around him. I mean, there's no prophet like him. So large crowds, okay, when I mean by large, I mean thousands, literally thousands, tens of thousands of people were traveling with Jesus. And turning to them, he said, and this is just the amazing part, as the older I get, the more I realize that God is not concerned about numbers. We are. We, you know, count everything, which is okay. I think we should count, you know, especially offerings. We especially count that. But, you know, I realize the more you live, the more I realize God has a different plan. His plan is, I need some committed people. And if that's 3 or 5 or 10 or 1,000, that's great. It's not about the number. It's about the commission, right? So great crowds accompany him, okay? Now, he turns to them. He says this crazy thing. It's crazy. It was crazy back then. It's crazy nowadays. If anyone comes to me and does not hate, that's a strong word for scripture, right? Hate his own father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters. We kind of hate our brothers, so that's easy. But the rest is kind of hard. Even his own life, that's even harder, right? He cannot be my disciple. I'll just read this version then. Keep on going. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. You can go on. For which of you desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Okay, you can go on. Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, it's normal. Most people say, dude, this guy's not very wise, you know. You don't just start something, you don't finish it. So you start something, and people obviously will begin to gossip, right? They will mock you for that. Go on. Saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Verse 31. Or what king going out to encounter another king in war will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Go on. And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. Next verse. So therefore, any of you who does not renounce all. That's important. I would underline them. I would emphasize that. Denounce all. Renounce all. That he is, cannot be my disciple. I'm going to just end up here. You can go back to the slide. Tonight, as I said, I want to talk about fan or follower. There's a good book about the cost of being a disciple of Jesus. Bonhoeffer, who was a German pastor living in World War II, he wrote a great book on that. It's kind of thick for those that don't read, so start with something small. But still, I would encourage you guys that read that book. It's amazing. It's quite old, but it's still great. The cost of discipleship. It's amazing. Even now, it's prophetic for our days especially. Okay, thank you. So it's the summer of 2008. We are in the middle of August. Quick background. I just came back from Romania. I went there for school, 2004, 2008. Got my bachelor's in pastoral theology. I come back home. Sure enough, everything is like blown up here. Obama is about to be the next president. It's not about that. It's about the Olympics. So I grew up without a TV in my house. So you can imagine every time. And I was a sporty type of guy. So every time I got a chance to see the Olympics, I was like glued on that television. So for 4 years, I haven't seen anything. And here we are. It's Beijing is hosting the Summer Olympic Games. Everybody's kind of expecting something great to happen. You know why? Because on that stage in Beijing, there's a guy by the name of Michael. Help me out. Michael? Swimmer. Michael Phelps. Have you guys heard of him? Hand up. You guys go swimming, right? A lot of you. Okay. So here's Michael Phelps, the American swimmer. He has already won 6 gold medals. He's fighting for his 7th gold medal. Now, this is amazing. It's a 100-meter fly. For those that have tried swimming, butterfly is the hardest out of all 4 of them. Okay. He's up against the Serbian called Milo Čavić. He's having the greatest race of his life. This Serbian, this guy is killing it, all right? Now, Michael Phelps needs this win because with a gold here, he ties another American swimmer by the name of Mark Spitz, who in 1972 breaks the record. He gets 7 gold medals in 1 Summer Olympic, which is amazing anyways, because, I mean, that's been 30-some years, 36 years to be more exact, ever since nothing has happened. Nobody has even come close to tying Mark Spitz's record. So here's my Michael Phelps, all right, going for a 7th medal. Now, he starts very slow. Halfway, he's about the 7th out of the 8th, so he's not doing really well. There's no room from, like, the last 50 meters. There's no room for any type of error. With 5 meters to go, he realizes, I got no chance. But he does something quite spectacular. He's never done this before. So instead of me talking about that, let's just watch that, all right? It's like 2 minutes. Do you guys mind if we watch that? It's not TV, okay? All right. It's YouTube. I guess it's okay. All right. So let's, can we watch it just a little bit? You don't have to see everything, but.
Packed stadium watching. Well, watching an average start there for Michael Phelps, and that's the first one of those we've seen, and I don't think he can afford to do this. He needs to be close to Cabbage at the 50.
Well, he had a good rest, had 24 hours rest, but Cabbage is going like a train. We're not sure if Phelps has got enough energy for this race, Andy. He's got to get a big turn here, but Cabbage is taking it to him. Well, very, very tight indeed, and Phelps hasn't got the greatest turn either. Now, Phelps does come back in 5. Phelps must be lying in about 3rd or 4th position at the moment. Cabbage still leading for Serbia. Is it going to be the 7th hurdle that he's going to fall at? He's coming back. He's coming back very strongly, Michael Phelps. Surely he can't do this from this space. Michael Phelps is coming back in 5. Is he going to get the touch? No, he's not. Oh, no. He's got it. Oh, he's got it. Oh, Michael
tight,
Phelps.
Tight.
Oh, he's tight. He's not Adrian, 100. He's got the gold.
Oh, no
50.58, Michael Phelps, 1/100th of a second. I cannot believe he's just done that. Michael Phelps was absolutely nowhere with 10 meters to go. He did exactly the same in Athens 4 years ago. Michael Phelps, you are absolutely invincible.
I want to watch this finish. I mean, we've got the start here, but you know what? Cabbage goes in half a stroke ahead of Phelps. I don't know what happened there at the finish, but Phelps jabbed the wall.
please show the finish. This is a start. Phelps didn't have a good one. He had a stinker. Cavitch was leading by a good half a second. Phelps way down the field, but please show us this finish. I want a super slow-mo of the finish. Here we go. Look, Cavitch is in. This, I'm not sure what's happened here, you know.
He's not in yet.
No, he's not. No, he's not. Look, look, look. You are kidding me.
Look.
You are kidding me. They've just shown that on the big screen. That was just gone to the crowd.
Oh, my word. Oh, how much has it made? 7 goals in 7 days.
Okay, thank you. It's getting excited. I want to go in the pool right now. Come on. I want to race Michael Phelps. So usually towards the end, right, for those that have done any type of swimming, you glide, right, for the last 5 meters. You don't do another one lap because it's like it's a lot of effort and energy to get out of the water and then to touch the cement board, whatever block thing. So Čović, he says, you know, I'm going to just glide through this. This is just a normal thing. It's done. It's over with. And Phelps is like, man, I got one more chance. 1/100 of a second. That's amazing. That's really amazing. So anyways, Michael Phelps goes on to win not just the 7th medal. He goes on to win 8 gold medals. And he breaks Spitz's record 36 years later, right? I'm not sure who's going to be able to get close to his record. Nevertheless, this is just awesome. I mean, if you guys watched the Olympics, it kind of gives you hype and it's exciting. It's you want to go and, like, you know, reach the Everest after this race. Now, here's what most people don't know about 2008. Besides the fact that Michael Phelps broke the record, you can go on to the next slide. Most people don't know that in the same year, Phelps visited an ordinary school, swimming school club, where he met a young Singapore kid by the name of Joseph Schooling. Now, a lot of kids go swimming, like most of our Romanian parents, you know, trebuie să facă și un pic de not, you know, a little piano, right? That type of thing. So Michael Phelps visits just an ordinary type of swimming club, and he finds this young kid who is in love with Michael Phelps. He's not just a fan of Michael Phelps. He's a follower, a devoted follower of Michael Phelps. Now, the reason why I say that is because and you'll see later on, there's a story behind this. No, go back. All right, thank you. I'm going to leave that for, there's a story behind this. So he becomes not just a fan, he becomes a disciple of Michael Phelps. Not directly, I mean, he's not calling Michael Phelps in every day, but indirectly, he's studying all the films. He studied all the moves. Joseph Schooling pretty much studied his diet, 10,000 calories per day. He studies his rigorous discipline, waking up at 4:30, 5 o'clock every morning. I got a nephew who's top 20 right now in the states of Michigan. He's waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning. He's in 9th grade. So this is the kind of rigorous discipline that you got to get into to even get close. Only the top 2 out of every state get to go to the Olympics trials. So you can imagine this kid, he wants to get really far, okay? 8 years later, Joseph Schooling, you can go on to the next slide. No, there's what I want. Check this out. Brazil, Rio, Olympic Games, that child that he met 8 years ago, that punk that had no chance, beats his record and beats Michael Phelps to get the gold medal. 2016, 8 years later. That's not a long time. So, and you can see, I mean, he's very young, you know, 2016, that's 4 years ago. I'm not sure what they're going to do in 2020. They delayed the summer. Anyways, so it's just, it goes on to show you that there's a huge difference between being just a fan. I was a fan of Michael Phelps. I was cheering him on. I even went to the swimming pool to see how butterfly works. I kind of gave up on that. But I realized there's some people in this world that go beyond fans. Just to go beyond, you know, cheering you on, shouting, or paying for a ticket, or going to a football game. There's some people, and there are not a lot of these, disciples I would call them, of Jesus or of some other athletes, that go the whole way. All right? So many people admired Phelps. I was one of them. You were probably one of them. But few and far off between were willing to walk his walk, eat what he ate, wake up at the same time that he woke up, do the same discipline, and study his moves and so on. You can go on to the next slide. So it got me thinking about so many people that we admire. For example, if you have any history behind Romanian parents, you could ask them if you don't know about his story. So here's Richard Wurmbrand. He's a Romanian, the voice of martyrs. You probably heard of that, right? Persecution.com and .org. So he's the founder of that. This man in 19, right? I'm not sure exactly, 60s or something like that, he stands up against the communism right when they're having their rally, right? It's kind of like the presidential rallies where, and he was an atheist back then, right? So he finally meets Jesus and he realizes that his atheism, what he was brought up into his schooling education was so wrong. And so he stands up in the middle of this rally and says, what you guys are doing is wrong. Now, before that, he was a coward, by the way. He didn't want to do that. But his wife said, hey, I'd rather have a husband that goes to jail than a husband that has no courage or fear to stand up for the truth. And he's like, with that attitude, I'm going to stand up. I mean, if you're willing to go all the way with me, I'll do it. And so that's what he did. He stood up. I mean, we're talking about 1,000 people, right, cheering the president, you know, Ceausescu, the greatest man on earth. And he says, no, you're not the greatest. Communism is not what's supposed to be. Because of that, he gets 14 years of prison time, 3 years in solitary confinement. He sees no light. He loses track of time. He has no history. He's no God, no presence. He's got no future. He doesn't even know what time it is. He doesn't know what time of day it is. He doesn't know what season in life he is. So what I'm trying to say is that many people admired that, even back then. But there were not a lot of people that were willing to go with him all the way to prison to stand up for the truth. And by the way, I think there will be coming a time here in America when socialism is the new deal. I mean, if you go to any liberal school, good school, you will see that this is the new trend. And so we're not that far off, I can tell you, maybe 20, maybe 50 years. But believe me, we're going to have to get ready for this, okay? So, but my point is that few were willing to go with him to jail and be tortured for Christ, which, by the way, is a book that he wrote, Torture for Christ. Trei Îndoros, Nicolae Moldoveanu, the songs that they wrote in prison, these are profound songs because somebody was willing to go beyond a fan. They're willing to be followers and disciples of Jesus. Now, you can go on to the next slide. You guys heard of Mother Teresa, right? Come on, you have to have heard about this woman, right? So we know her work. We know she did amazing things for the children of the poorest of India, right? Now, I'm pretty sure a lot of people gave a lot of money for India. But how many women were willing to give up their status and careers to go to India like she did? See, that's the difference between admiring somebody and willing to go all the way with them. And so, reading the scripture, what I realize is, again, going back to verse 25, Jesus is not very fond of large crowds because he realizes that people will cheer you on when it comes to, you know, seeing great things happen, miracles, and winning a gold medal. But when it comes to the grind of every day doing these things, most people will say, no, thank you, Jesus. I'll go my own way. And by the way, if you read the context of Luke chapter 14, you will see that that is the context, right? The pair of the great banquet. So here's the king, which is not the God the Father. He's trying to give the greatest banquet ever. And he goes to the people that were supposed to technically be there. And they say, well, no, Jesus, you know, I kind of have things to do, business, family issues and COVID, whatever. You know, it's like, and so the king is so upset. He says, you know what, just go anywhere. You know, go in the country lanes, go and just make these people come to and get a taste of my banquet. And after that comes this parable, or not the parable, the text that I just read, the cost of being a disciple. Now, many people admired Jesus, but few were willing to go with him all the way. In John chapter 6, the Bible says when he talked about the body and his blood being the bread and the wine, people said, dude, you're crazy, man. We're not cannibals, you know what I mean? It's like, we're out of here. And the Bible says that Jesus was not like, please, come on, don't go. I mean, if you guys leave, my fans, you know, my followers are on Facebook, it's going to go from like 2,000 to like 12. What's going to happen? I mean, my account is going to get shut down by Facebook. Something's going to... He's like, listen, aren't you guys going? That is such a different attitude. I mean, if we would lose half of our youth, we'd be like, dude, what are we doing wrong? You know what I mean? And it's okay to evaluate what you're doing. But what I'm trying to say is that don't be impressed by numbers. The more I live and the more I do ministry, the more I realize that you don't do miracles with numbers. with crowds. You do miracles with a few that are dedicated, right? The Marines, the few, the proud, the Marines. If you guys saw that commercial before, that is so true. I mean, you see it in the military, you see it in the Marines, you see it in usually in high places, you'll see that they don't want thousands or like tens of thousands of people. They want the few, the proud. They want the people that are willing to go all the way and count the cost and pay the price to be disciples of Jesus. Now, don't get me wrong. I think it's better to be a fan of Jesus than to be an enemy of Jesus, right? So, yeah, it's good to be a fan. But what I'm trying to say tonight, and this is my heart for you guys. I don't know most of you guys. I don't know what your life is with Jesus. I don't know if you guys are born again or just come to church because, you know, parents kind of force you or you just got a good Christian education. What I do want to say tonight is I hope you're going to go move towards the next step. You can be a fan. It's okay. It's better than, you know, not coming at all. But what I'm saying is that go the next step. Go all the way. Be a follower, a true, dedicated, consecrated, sacrifice, all out. I mean, I'm all in this, you know what I mean, with Jesus thing. It's not just a matter of a Sunday or a youth thing. It's a matter of my life giving it to God. Isn't that what the Bible says, right? Let me go back. In the same time, if any of you go to verse 33, if you want to, Luke chapter 14, verse 33. I mean, for me, this is just mind-boggling. And I'll be honest with you, so many times we read these verses and you kind of go back to our old lifestyles, but it's not that. It's not that. You can go back to Luke 14, verse 33. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything, says in NIV, all right? The ESV says you give it all, all right? Underline all. I mean, if you're not willing to give it all, you're just a fan. You're just like me who cheers Michael Phelps, but will never, ever wake up at 5:30 in the morning. I'm not a morning person, by the way. You're just a fan. And I just want to say that I believe so many of our churches, we kind of host fans. We kind of like that in a way. And I believe that this pandemic is a way of showing us who are the true fans. Because some fans are not fans at all. And who are the true disciples, true followers of Jesus. I do believe that this is a time where the church, if it's not going to wake up, it's never going to wake up. I mean, from my perspective, this is the time. Fans are good. They cry. They shout. They sing. They clap. They get dressed in such a way that shows their true devotion. Like, what do you guys say if you're Sacramento? Something. Kings? Yeah, basketball. Something else. You guys have football? No football? 49ers. Yes. I mean, if you go to a 49ers football game, you guys were like in the Super Bowl last year, right? Something like that. Anyways, I mean, everybody's dressed in red, right? These are the 49ers. I mean, you don't go to these games if you're not a true fan of a San Francisco 49ers, right? The football team. So what I'm trying to say is that fans, they do all these things. They also believe in rituals, by the way. I mean, there's a lot of ritual going on, even in football games, right? They're ready to pay a price, a ticket, that is, to come and watch a game or, who knows, worship service or a church service. Fans, however, have one problem. It's not small, actually. It's essential. One problem. They don't go all the way. They will only do what is minimally required. Like that student that has Mr. Forster. What does it take for a C+? You know, if you guys know the students or, you know, when I was in school, we used to do that. Teacher, for like just to pass the class, what do we need to take? You know, what is exactly like the least minimal requirements of this class? All right, that's what we'll do. You know, and it's like, okay, that's okay, but it's not really okay because it's not the right mentality. That's not the right attitude. And that's what I feel like so many of us are just like the students and say, you know, what is the minimal requirement of discipleship, of truly following Jesus? You know, what is the minimum thing that we can do? We're not asking God, how much do I have to do? Or do I have to give it all, God? I'm ready to give. I mean, I don't think God necessarily asks for all of it, but I have to be willing to give it all. And from my perspective, that is where our heart is supposed to be. Fans, therefore, have one problem. They don't go all the way. Don't ask for more. They've done their part. Don't ask them to get in the game. They've paid the ticket to watch the game. They're not going to get in the game. And that's what I believe there's a difference. My exhortation tonight for you guys is don't just be fans of Jesus. Please, by all means. Don't just be lukewarm. Because from my perspective, fans are just lukewarm. They're not enemies. They're not cold. They're not, you know, on fire for Jesus either. They're just lukewarm. They'll do the minimum requirement of the church, right? For far too long, and I just, I'm going to say a couple things about my life. For far too long, I was just a fan. I came to church ever since I was 12. I used to sing in the choir. Oh, what a good little boy. I mean, just the nice kid coming to church ever since I was young. And it was okay. I started singing in a band. I kind of gave up on that 2 years later with the trumpet. So I stuck with the choir. And this is back in Michigan, by the way, when I was at Middle Belt. And man, I just remember those days. I was just a fan. I kind of liked coming to church sometimes. I paid my dues. I came to some practice and so on. But at 18 years old, when God really, you know, said, you know, it's great, but it's not enough. So I remember the summer of 2004, I got enrolled at University of Michigan. I was supposed to be a CIS program, a computer information guy, a geek, SWAT, working at Best Buy somewhere. Or maybe, yes. Hey, man, they make a lot of money, man. I dreamed about a 6K figure salary, just like, you know, any Romanian Christian boy does, right? I mean, this is what we're taught in church, right? You know, get a good job and get a nice girl and make a lot of kids. Not really, not anymore. But, you know, it's just, it was like one of those things where, like, you know, you kind of like grew up to, like, Lord, I want to, you know, just fulfill that American dream, you know? Came here when I was 9, I was 18. I was like, Lord, this is just an opportunity for me. This is amazing. It's going to be awesome. So 2 weeks before starting school, this is like, no kidding, 2 weeks before starting school, I was at a wedding at Pardee, for those of you that know the church. And I was sitting like in the second row somewhere, like bored out of my mind. You know, like a lot of weddings in churches, in Romanian churches. And here was like another one. I was like 18, like, dude, I don't care about these things. And as I was going through my classes, because, you know, you could pick your classes, and I was like, okay, first semester, second prerequisites, you know, what's the next class? And kind of going through that, just a thought came in my mind. It's like, Adrian, this is amazing that you want to plan your life for like next 4 years, but what do you want to do for me? It's like, boom, just lightning, flash, thunder just hit me. And all of a sudden, I was like, where does this come from? You know, it's like, I was not even reading scripture. So, you know, and that thought, as I was going to the to eat, you know, at the restaurant with my family, I was like, man, God, what is this? What exactly do you want from me? And sure enough, you know, 2 weeks later, I was in Romania, you know, going for theology school. And my dad thought I was crazy. My brothers thought I was sort of crazy. I didn't know exactly what to think of it, but I mean, God spoke clearly through a couple of dreams in my heart. And I was like, man, this is the right thing to do. What I'm trying to say is that up until that point, I could say I was a fan, but I was not ready to give up everything. When God called me to give up everything, and I'm by no means a saint. I have faults of my own, but I think there comes a point of our lives, whether sooner or later, when God will test you. He will test your heart. He wants to know if you're going to be Joseph Schooling or you're just going to be like Adi Vlad, is going to watch those Olympics and is going to cheer these people on, but he'll never go on to win a gold medal because he doesn't take the time and the effort to put in that. Sooner or later, God will test your heart. And it might not be just once. It might be more often than you think. And you have to be willing, from my perspective, to give it up all of it, right? Verse 33, in the same way, any of you who does not give up everything cannot be my disciple. Attention, it doesn't talk about being a member of a church. It doesn't talk about even being, you know, part of a Christian denomination. It's about being a disciple. I'm not saying you're not part of any of that. I think you have to be. If you love Jesus, you're a disciple of Jesus, you are part of a church, local church that is, right? So I'm not against that. But what I'm saying is that it's about being a disciple of Jesus. So from my perspective, a disciple of Jesus does at least two things. First of all, he hears and obeys. No questions asked. All right? You leave everything behind. You take up the cross and you walk in Jesus' footsteps. Everything. Everything. I mean, literally, if you have to give it up to go back to Romania, like, where's that on the map? You'll find it. Trust me. You will. All right? You have to be willing to do that. Everybody's asking me, like, you know, what's wrong with you? I mean, where do you live in Romania? It's like, dude, it's like, I'm not going to like a third world country somewhere, man. And it's not even about that. If God would ask me to go, I would give it all up. I mean, really, is it about me here? Is it about the, you know, Californian dream? Is it about that? Is it about being a true disciple of Jesus? Now, you don't have to go to Romania. You don't have to go to Africa. What I'm saying is that where is your heart? Because ultimately, it comes down to that, right? So the rich young ruler, the Bible says, could not give it all up. And by the way, Jesus was not saying, hey, you know, give me all your money. That's not what he was saying. He's like, listen, you want to be a good investor? You want to be wise? You know, because he was talking to Jews, and we know Jews are businessmen, all right? So he's not saying, listen, give it all up for me. I'm going to put it in my pocket. He's like, if you want your investments to count, it's not for your 401k or your IRA. It's about your investments that are sure in heaven. Matthew chapter 6, right? So he says, if you want your riches, if you want all of that to mean something in light of eternity, give it all up for Christ. And Christ will ultimately give it back to you 100-fold, right? Coming back for you. So the Bible says that he could not do that because his heart was in the wrong place, right? Peter sees this whole issue, this whole scene, and says, teacher, you know, we've left everything. And God says, that's great, Peter, because you've left everything, but you're going to gain 100-fold back. Brothers, sisters, family, and even those riches that you left behind. And obviously, that comes with persecution as well. So a disciple of Jesus hears the call of Christ. It doesn't matter where. Young people, and this is a beef I have with the Romanian community. Sorry, Brother Moise, it's not against you. But, man, it's like so many families, you know, they put their careers way before they put their Christian identities. So I'm not a lawyer. I'm a Christian lawyer. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm a Christian medical. Ultimately, I am defined by who I am in Christ. And if that does not define me, I am not a true disciple of Jesus because I can't put anything else. He was talking about family here, but I would say, go on, Jesus. If anyone does not hate his career, okay, put it that way, father, mother, whatever else, you know, riches or whatever else, more than, and if you don't love Jesus more than all of that, let's just put it in a positive way, then you're not worthy to be his disciple. And by the way, he doesn't need tens of thousands of followers. He just needs a couple of people that are willing to give up everything. So a true disciple of Jesus hears and obeys. And the second thing is a disciple of Jesus, from my perspective, based on what scripture says in Matthew 6, chapter 6, verse 33, it says, the disciple of Jesus is consumed with God's work, with the kingdom work. Yeah, of course, a disciple of Jesus works. He goes to school. He goes grocery shopping. He might go to the gym, right? Some of you guys go to the gym. It's not bad. You might play some sports. You might go fishing, hunting, you know, whatever you do in life. But these things don't define us. Young people, these things should never define us. And when they become the definition of what our lives have become, then we got it all messed up. And I think this was this pandemic thing is really bringing, I mean, we have to stay home and you know, right in the mirror and say, okay, who am I really? Because I can't work right now. I can't go to church right now. I can't do so many other extracurricular activities. Who am I? And that's ultimately the question that we have to ask and we have to respond and say, God, I am your son. I'm your disciple. And I'm willing to give it all up for your kingdom. So a disciple of Jesus is consumed with his work. He's involved. Local church, the kingdom work, the global church, wherever God is leading you, you are definitely consumed with God's work. You seek his kingdom first. First, that is your priority. May God help us. Toby Mac, I'm not necessarily a fan of his, but he does have, at one point, one of his songs, he says, right at the end, I love that. It stuck to me. It's been like 15 years ever since. May your kingdom be, if you guys remember, what wakes me up and lays me down. I love that. May your kingdom be what wakes me up in the morning, at 5:30 in the morning if I have to, and what lays me down at night with the same thought. Man, tomorrow morning, I'm going to go back to my workplace, school, education, wherever I go, and I'm going to seek the kingdom first. I'm going to make God's name shine forever. That is a true disciple of Jesus. I want to be Joseph Schooling, but not for Michael Phelps. Because you know those gold medals, they're going to go away. I got a couple of those for tennis. I used to be a tennis player, by the way. I played 7.5 years back in Michigan. I played with Sharapova back then. So I probably had a career, maybe, you know, just things kind of went in different directions. So I have gold medals at home, But they're like, I just found them right now. I was like, I was digging on like a lot of, you know, old junk stuff. And I'm like, man, this is what they become. So it's okay to study and work and learn for, you know, gold medal for, you know, career. But ultimately, I want to be a Joseph Schooling for God's kingdom. I want to be a Joseph Schooling for God's. I want to be a disciple of Jesus, and that everybody would know that. Your family, my kids, I got three kids, man, I want them that Jesus, Adi, my dad, loves Jesus more than anything in this world. Anything. I mean, really, I will be giving, willing to give it all up for him. And I want my kids to know that. That's their true value. That's who they're going to become themselves when they see in me that I'm a follower of Jesus. And so tonight, I just want to, this is my encouragement. Don't just be a fan. Be a follower, a true follower of Jesus. He needs you guys. Sacramento needs you guys. Young people need you guys. I mean, they're so desperate nowadays, depressed, you know, just all over the place, right? Without direction. And you guys, as disciples of Jesus, can bring that light, that beacon of light into a world of darkness. Amen. God bless you guys.
God bless you. Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and stand. And as he mentioned,